So here you have in Genesis 1, you have the creation of the world beginning with a formless mass of water. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Now it's debated whether we're talking about creation from nothing here. It's not absolutely clear. It's debated. There's no question but that the Bible teaches that God created from nothing. The only question is, do we learn that from Genesis 1:1 and following? It might not have been a question that was interesting to the Hebrews at this moment. But what is interesting is that at the beginning, the world is seen as formless and empty, which we might picture as a great blob, watery blob. And from this, rather than fighting against this water, as you see in the Babylonian and Canaanite accounts, God, through the power of his word, shapes this disordered matter into order over 6 days. And these 6 days are interestingly related to each other, and probably is another indication that we're dealing here with a literary account of creation rather than an actual sort of literal description of how God created it. In other words, the first 3 days are the creation of realms, followed by the creation of the inhabitants of those realms. So that on day one, you have the creation of light and darkness. On day four, the inhabitants of the realms of light and darkness, namely the sun, moon, and stars. Day two, the separation of the sky from the sea. On day five, the inhabitants of the sky, the birds, and the inhabitant of the sea, the fish. On day three, you have the creation of land, and on day and also the vegetation which comes forth from it. And then on day six, you have the creation of land animals, and also you have the creation, of course, of human beings, the apex of God's creation. And so, again, I think we're to look at Genesis 1 and also Genesis 2, not giving us an account of how God created creation, but telling us that he did it, and also telling us some very important things about God, ourselves, and our world. And we'll come back to this when we look at Genesis 2, 4b through 25 as well. But let me focus here at the end of our lesson now on the fact that human beings are here described as created in the image of God. Again, these creation accounts are foundational to give us a worldview, to help us think about who is God. God is our creator. God is not coexistent with creation. He is transcendent. He's other than creation, but he's involved with creation. This is classic theism. God is both transcendent and immanent. And human beings are created in God's image. And that, of course, on the surface of it, is a highly dignified view of humanity, which contrasts with the rather contemptible view that we've seen develop in the Babylonian account. But what does it mean to be created in the image of God? Now, there's a lot of debate about this, so let me just say that I think the best way to answer that question is to look and see how the words image and likeness are used elsewhere in Scripture. And when we do, we see that it's used of statues of kings, statues that kings place around their kingdom in order to represent their power and authority in their kingdom. So I think, and I'm not alone in this by any stretch of the imagination, that when it says that we're created in the image of God, it means that we reflect the glory of God. We reflect the glory like the moon reflects the light of the sun, and that we are commissioned by God to subdue and rule in creation, which of course is kingly and queenly language, and it's a language not to violate and pillage, but it's a language to care for and steward creation. So in the first creation account, we are introduced to this powerful, sovereign God who creates human beings in his image for the purpose of caring for creation.